Ladies and gentlemen, in recognition of tonight's special occasion, I have invoked my privilege as an early volunteer in this museum to once again don the black math encounters uniform and come up here to help kick things off. And I have decided that seeing as how this is Erik Demaine's second stint here as the math encounter speakers, he deserves two introductions this evening. So I'm going to give a very brief one, and then another gentleman will give a much better one than I can give. And really all I want to say is that Erik and his mathematics and his love of mathematics have been a mainstay of the museum from its very beginning, since before it opened with the first Math Encounters. He was a keynote speaker at our first MOVES conference. It's a summer conference we have every other year on the mathematics of various entertaining subjects. But it is a serious math conference, I promise you. And here again, of course, to mark our fifth anniversary. What Erik, I'm pretty sure, doesn't know is that his name keeps coming up in the museum even when he's not himself around. And I'll give you just one example. If you look upstairs, you will find a lovely bench designed by another volunteer to the museum, which has the interesting property that it has hinges and the bench can be adjusted to take either the shape of a triangle or an equilateral triangle or a square. So it's made of multiple hinge pieces and it can transform between these two seemingly very different shapes. So if you've never come to the museum and tried out that bench, you really should. It's a delightful thing. And this was the subject of a problem published by either Dewdney or Lloyd. I get the two of them confused, I'm sorry. In which? Dewdney, yes, of course Erik would know that. Dewdney. In 1906, it was called the Haberdasher's Puzzle. At the time, how could this be done? And it was noted that it had this solution in which the pieces never disconnect, they just hinge around each other. And so three times a month, we have a session in the museum where we talk about the mathematics of the various exhibits. And one of our sessions was on the topic of this bench. And somebody asked, so, you know, I know that if you take any polygon, it can be cut into pieces, the pieces can be rearranged to form any other polygon of the same area, but can that be done with these hinged, you know, constructions? And I said, wow, that's a really good question. I don't know the answer, which, by the way, this is part of the training of every single volunteer and person working on the floor, is that when you get a question that you're not sure about, you always say, wow, that's a really good question. I don't know the answer. So that's what I said, because I really had no idea. I said, but I'll look it up, and for our next session, I'll tell you what the status of that is. And sure enough, I went back, and I discovered that in 2006, exactly 100 years later, a paper was published by none other than our Erik Demaine and several other authors, proving that, in fact, the rearrangement of any polygon to any other polygon of the same area can be done entirely with a hinged dissection. So the pieces never separate, they just rotate around their vertices. So once again, it was Erik Demaine saving the day here in the museum, and by the way, solving a 100-year-old open problem, which leads me to the suggestion of a new metric on mathematicians, which Erik has quite generously agreed to now calculate the values for many mathematicians, which is take the sum of the ages of all of the open problems they have solved in years. And you guys know who my money is on. And with that, let me give you Cindy Lawrence, the executive director and CEO of the museum.
Thank you, Glenn. So I would be remiss if I didn't start out by thanking the Simons Foundation, without whom we wouldn't have had 5 years of Math Encounters. So our gratitude to the Simons Foundation. One other thing I thought would be fun to do tonight in honor of our fifth anniversary would be to have just a brief retrospective video of the first 5 years of Math Encounters. I'd like to thank Mike Andrakovich for putting the video together for us, and actually our summer interns all had a hand in picking out the clips from all the Math Encounters videos of the last 5 years, so I hope you'll enjoy.
I'm really delighted to invite you to the first of this series of math encounters. And you'll see what that means during the course of the during the course of the evening.
I'm Erik Demaine, and I love math. Who's with me?
So it got its name hundreds of years after he was dead. He didn't invent it, and he just put it in an example. So, it's been kind of lucky that we call that the Fibonacci sequence, because he had almost nothing to do with it.
Can you see that? But if you keep pulling, what happens is that they pop.
Suddenly, it's starting to have some kind of personality.
Like, whoa, this is so cool, don't you think this is cool?
I can make a more complicated three-blade knife. Here is the bagel. The magic knife will take it apart and give you three interlocking rings.
So, don't believe what you see.
You get an elegant closed curve in space, and then you get the sheets forming it. There are no creases anywhere, and no one knows how to compute what this thing will look like except by doing what you're doing, taping it. That's again the frontier of mathematics. Thank you very much.
Oh, you guys, you should have picked stars, because it's totally stars. That's what it looks like. I know, isn't it amazing?
Tile that joins up all of those intersections. It turns out that you can decompose this pattern in a clean way into a tiling of the plane that has a little fragment of the pattern, a single motif, inscribed in every tile.
Please wake up.
Everybody thinks when you juggle, the balls go in a circle. If you see a picture of a clown juggling, the balls are actually going in a circle. In fact, as most of you will know, that shouldn't be a circle. If you ignore air resistance, it's if you take away all the air, you'll die. But no, if you ignore air resistance, then actually it's a parabola. Technically, it's not a parabola. Actually, it's an ellipse because the Earth's gravitational field is not uniform. It gets less as you go up, and it slopes in like that. Don't worry about it. It doesn't matter. But anyway, it goes basically the easy path. By the way, the fact that I know things like that should worry you just a little bit, all right? But the balls go round in this cyclic pattern. That's the easy one to understand.
So I'm going to put some soapy water on it. See, it's good for that. And let's try a couple of bubbles here. First a little one and then a big one. There you can see that little bubble pushing into the big bubble, right? No question about it. That's right. That's right.
Do we all not agree that Inside Out is still based on what looks like a t-shirt? So t-shirt inside out is based in the same shape as a t-shirt right side in.
The reason they gave was that if the Earth went around the Sun, then we would see different constellations every 6 months because of parallax. Unless, of course, the stars were ridiculously far away, so far away that you couldn't see the parallax with the naked eye, but that would be ridiculous.
I'll show you what it does. Here, I can do the whole thing all at once now. Let's try that again.
That could have encoded one half. And so part of the thrill and the excitement and the bewilderment and all of that bundled up together is, for me, part of mathematics. When you have an option, when it comes to encoding a mathematical idea, that you can either become overwhelmed by the number of options, or you can see that as a glorious opportunity to be very creative.
190,969 push-up if I needed push-up, pick 190, add that to tough off to get 378,969. Yes! Good! Thank you all very much.
Kale, my plane more sphere. I challenge and I dare ya. Find more surface area. Hail, kale, my plane nor sphere. Its curvature is negative.
Thanks.
I hope everyone enjoyed that. And now I'd like to bring up someone to do the real introduction of Erik. I'm going to call up Mark Seta Ducati, who is a game designer, an inventor, and a founder of one of the most fun conferences that you can ever attend called Gathering for Gardner. So, Mark?
It takes a minute. So you can see over here. Okay. Oh. Okay, there I am. I was a little younger then. Welcome to Math Encounters, and tonight's topic is magic and math. So I think I'll do a little magic. But first, I'll show you a little sculpture that I designed a number of years ago, and this represents a palindrome, because a palindrome is words that you can say forwards and backwards. And if you say the sentence, "Is it a car or a cat I saw?" That whole sentence is actually a palindrome. And this little sculpture is a little palindrome because it's unusual. So is it a car or a cat I saw? But the interesting thing about this sculpture is if you turn it around, the palindrome doesn't work because here we have two objects, but on the other side, on this side, we have three things. We have a number 8, a man, and an arrow. I haven't figured out a palindrome for this side yet. I'm still working on it, but if anybody comes on this side, we have, well, where are we? Here was the 8 and the man, and here is the car and the cat. All right, well, that's just a little diversion. So in 1999, I authored a book. I created this book called The Magic Show, and it's the first, some people know it. Well, that's all right. Thank you. Unfortunately, it's out of print now, but I still like the book, so I brought it up to show one of the tricks. But in order to show one of the tricks and maybe a few other card tricks, I do need a volunteer from the audience. Would anybody like to volunteer? You all the way over there in the corner? The bigger one, you. Because you're bigger this way, I mean. Come on over here. What's your name, sir? Devin. Sit right over here. Devin. Let me shake your hand. Come in a little over here. Nice to meet you. Now, the important question, are you a magician?
I like
magic. Okay, well, that's good. Okay. All right, can you talk in the mic? When you're going to talk, can you say your name and that you like magic?
My name is Devin and I like magic.
Perfect. Okay, so we'll do a trick out of the magic show. It's a book of interactive magic, and I have a card trick here that I like. This is the Magic Show book, and you see here there's four cards. And you can slide any one of those four cards up to the top. Just point to one of them that you like, any one of those four cards. Just point to it. That one there. Okay, now just slide it all the way up to the top into that little pocket on the top there, all the way. Okay, we'll see. All right, get it up there. Now you could have chosen one of the other cards. Now this book works totally the same way it would work if you were at home doing it without me here. I don't have to be with the book for the trick to work. So, oh, look, you got a nice card. You got the Queen of Hearts. You could have taken a Jack or a King, or but you did get the Queen of Hearts. There's a little envelope here with the prediction that I made before. You see, I'm pointing to the prediction. That's me. Okay, we'll open it up, and let's slide that right out. Can you get that out? Yeah, and take that little card out and read what it says on it.
The Queen of Hearts.
And the microphone.
Your card is the Queen of Hearts.
Yes! All right, you got the right card. Thank you very much, Devin. So we will move on and do some real card tricks. How about that? I have a real deck of cards here. Those were just little baby cards. Okay. All right, pay attention. This is your part. Let me give them a little. Get warmed up a little bit. Wait a minute. I better wind the cards up. All right, now that's ready. Take any one out that you like. All the way on the bottom. That shows something about his personality. I don't know what, but it shows something about your personality. Okay, and put it over there. Did everybody see the card? Okay. Now, the card sticks out in the middle, right about in the middle. See everybody, the card is in the middle. And I'm gonna push it in and shuffle it. Watch very carefully. I'm shuffling the card. Shuffling. Now you look like maybe you think that I'm really not shuffling it.
You are.
Oh yeah, I'm not. Okay. Come in a little closer. Let me give it one of these. Go like that. I'll shuffle it this way. I'll take some of the cards, I'll put them face up. Some face down, some face up. This really messes them up. Now they're really getting messed up. Is that right? They're all messed up. Some are face up, some are face down. Right?
Yep.
Okay, now you hold on to the cards real tight with both hands.
Okay, now, what was the name of your card into the microphone while you're holding onto those cards? Because I can't do anything while you're holding the cards.
King of clubs.
The king of clubs. Okay, now I have to do the magic. No, it's not the top card. Don't anticipate what I'm going to do. On the count of three, one, two, hold them tight. Okay. Now watch what happened. If I take the cards, and if we spread them like this, you see, all of the cards went the right way. Oh, except for one card. All of the cards, is it correct that all of the cards are the right way? Spread through yourself and see if all the cards are the right way. There's one that's face down, though. Hold that card, take that face down card and hold it up and see what it is. The king of clubs, look at that, all right. Yes, yes, yes. We'll try one or two other little tricks. I'll take less cards. This time we'll use less cards. Okay, we'll use those cards. This way it'll be a little easier to follow. We only have a little packet of cards, so mix them up. You know how to mix cards up? Yeah, just kind of mix them up.
Okay.
Okay, is that, okay, that's fine.
I can't mix them up.
All right, oh, you mix them up like this, see? Okay. And now you see, all the cards are different, right? They're all different. Is there one that you like more than another one?
Yes.
Okay, well, just take it out. Take that one out. And it's going to be easy for you to remember that card, right? Okay. So show it to everybody while I turn around, hold it up, and I'm closing my eyes. Show it to everybody, that card. Okay, and now, you can put the card back, it's fine. Hold on to the cards for a moment. Hold them real tight like that, because I'm going to give you instructions on what to do. I'm going to ask you what the card is. Don't say anything until I say you're ready. And you're going to tell me the name of the card. So, for example, we're going to use a table. You're going to use a table. I'll show you exactly what to do. Say, for example, the card was the Two of Clubs. So what you're going to do is you're going to spell out two, T-W-O, one card for each letter. Then you're going to take the remainder of the packet, place it on top. Then you'll spell out of, O-F, place that on top. And then clubs, C-L-U-B-S, and then put the remaining cards on top. And then finally, the most important part of the trick, you have to spell my name, because I have to do something in the trick. So my name is Mark, and you'll be spelling Mark, M-A-R-K. You got it? Now, I'm going to walk you through it. So I'm going to ask you the name of the card, but you can lie. You don't have to tell me the truth. You can make up a card or tell me the actual card that you chose. So just start with the number. Was it a two, a king, an ace, a five, a queen?
I'm able to lie?
Yeah, yeah. Isn't that... I know it's the first time that you're ever lying.
Two.
Two?
Two.
Okay. Now spell out one card from the top. Just deal them on it. T-W-O. Okay, put the rest on top. Now you could have said queen, which is a lot more cards, right? Now pick up the packet. Okay, now spell out of, O-F, O-F. The rest on top, pick them up. And now we get to the fun part, the suits. Now we have clubs, spades, hearts, diamonds, you know the suits. Just name one of the suits before you deal it. Just hold on. Just name it.
Diamonds.
Diamonds. Now, do you want to change it? Okay. Now, do you want to use an S or not an S? With diamond or diamonds? Your choice.
Diamonds.
With an S.
Yeah.
Okay. Spell it out.
D-I-A-M-O-N-D-S.
Now, the rest on top. Now, I told you, now comes the most important part of the trick. Pick up the packet. You have to spell my name, which is Mark, with the K.
M-A-R-K.
The rest on top. Now pick up the cards. Now, there was a lot of mixing, a lot of different combinations of diamonds or clubs or twos or queens that you could have had. Now you're holding the cards here. Hold them up, just hold your hand up just like that so everybody can see a little higher. See, this is the card, hold them right there like that. Now, the actual truth now. I'm saying that your card is on the top. What do you think the chances of that are? Pretty small, huh?
Yeah.
Well, what was the name? In the microphone, what was the name of your card?
Two of spades.
Oh, it really was a two. You just lied on the diamonds. That's interesting. That shows something about your personality also. Okay, turn over the two of spades and show everybody the two of spades. Yes, that is Very good. Thank you very much. We will now do one more thing, and we will introduce the speaker. Here, just shake your hand. You're going to hold the bag like that. I'm going to get some of these cards here, and we'll make some cards disappear. I take this off because sometimes people think that the cards go up my sleeve, but here we go. You'll hold the bag there. I'll take four cards, and one, two, see, it just disappears. Can everybody see? That's two. The ace comes next. Say the ace. That's the ace. There's a six. Oh, there it is. Okay. We'll try a few more cards. Hold the bag, because we're going to dump them in the bag. Okay. There's some more. Watch over here. An ace. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Devin. Thank you. So tonight we're here to honor Erik Demaine. Erik Demaine is a professor of computer science at MIT. In 2001, at the age of 20, Demaine joined the faculty of MIT as the youngest professor ever hired by the university. He has published over 300 papers and has won many awards, including a MacArthur Fellowship, the so-called Genius Award. A computer scientist, mathematician, artist, and author, he specializes in computational origami, the geometry of paper folding. I first met Erik at one of the early Gathering for Gardner conferences. At the gathering, we have an event where we have a sculpture garden, and mathematicians and artists make sculptures and play with sculptures and geometry. I remember Erik building and playing in the garden. Popular science describes him as the genius who plays for a living. And tonight, he is here to play with us. Please welcome and give a big hand for Erik Demaine.
Well, thanks. It's great to be here. It's hard to believe it's been 5 years of the Museum of Mathematics. And in fact, when I was here 5 years ago, there wasn't actually a physical museum. We met in another building. And it's exciting to be celebrating mathematics. And I really love studying the mathematics of playful things. I get to play for a living, basically. And today, I thought it would be fun to look at magic in particular and how we can use magic as an inspiration for mathematics and use mathematics to advance the world of magic. So I think there's a lot in common between math and magic. They're both always looking for surprise. Magicians are trying to surprise the audience. Mathematicians are trying to surprise each other and find things that you wouldn't expect to be true and yet are provably true. There's a similar sense of elegance trying to work with very simple things like playing cards or numbers and discovering really weird things about them. And they're both a lot of fun. So I want to bring them together through this world of mathemagic, which is, I think of in two different ways. One is to take a magic trick, like the ones you saw, like the last one is a mathematical trick, and try to analyze them mathematically, figure out what makes them work, and then use that to design new tricks. That's where it's really exciting. Maybe we can advance the frontiers of magic by developing new mathematics around existing tricks. So that's what I'm going to do. And I'm inspired a lot by this guy, Martin Gardner, who's sadly no longer with us. But he was originally a magician and then became a popular math writer and magic writer for Scientific American, published lots of books. We've published lots of books about him. There's the Gathering for Gardner conference in celebration of him. And he really brought together mathematics and fun and magic and puzzles. So You'll see, hear his name a few times in this talk. And I'm going to talk. I'm going to explore magic and illusion in three different settings, three different props: coins, and cards, and gravity illusion, and rope, and paper. So let's get started with coins. So if you didn't bring coins, it's okay. I have some coins here, right for you. Imagine you have three pennies, and you can arrange them heads or tails in whatever order you like. So there's eight different ways to do that. And here they all are. Now, my goal is to make your coins all the same. And I'm going to do that by a sequence of coin flips for all of you at once. So just focus in on one of your, whichever arrangement of coins you like. And I'm going to make your coins all the same. Now, if you chose from the top row, you're done. It was a little too easy. So pick a different one. Now, I'd like you to imagine the coins in your head and project an image of those coins into my mind. Getting mixed signals. I'm going to have to do you one at a time. So for starters, flip over the left coin. Are your coins now all the same? Raise your hand if they are. OK, you guys are impressed. Amazing. For the rest of you, flip over the middle coin. Are your coins now all the same? Yes? OK, you guys are impressed. And for the rest of you, I was just confused in the beginning. If you flip over the left coin again, now your coins are all the same, right? Yay. OK, very good. A lot of people at the end there. So in three moves, I could equalize any set of coins. I didn't need to know what they were ahead of time. Obviously, this is a fun trick. It goes back to the 80s. You can do it over the phone, impress all your friends, or not, maybe. But what's going on mathematically? So we wrote a paper about this. And the answer is you're, in some sense, navigating the hypercube of all the different arrangements of heads and tails. So here's heads, tails, tails. Here's tails, tails, tails. And I connect them with a link because they're just one coin flip away. If I flip the leftmost coin, we go from here to here. And my goal is to get to all tails or all heads. So it's essentially this cube of, with three coins, it's just a three-dimensional cube. That's easy to imagine. It's essentially this cube folded in half to bring the tail, tail, tails to be the same as the heads, heads, heads. And what I was doing is essentially walking this purple path that's been folded in half. And so it turns out the number of moves you need to do this is essentially half of the number of nodes over in this cube, which is exponential. If you have n coins, you're going to need about 2 to the n divided by 2 coin flips to make them all the same. And if you there's a lot of interesting mathematics here. It's a gray code or a Hamiltonian path. And that's the best you can do. So for three coins, it's only 3 moves, but for 4 coins, it's 7 moves, and for 5 coins, it's 15 moves, and so it goes up very quickly. This is what we call exponential growth. So that's a lot. Maybe you want to make it easier for the magician. Maybe instead of making the coins all the same, you want to make the number of heads and the number of tails the same. So I want to get to a configuration like this with a balance between heads and tails. This is actually really easy to do from any arrangement of coins. You flip over the first coin, ask if they're now equal, flip over the second coin, flip over the third coin, flip over, well, for 4 coins, you just need to flip the first 3. And in general, you just flip the first 3, first n minus 1 in order, and you're guaranteed to reach a place where the number of heads and tails are the same. And if you do it randomly, you actually get there faster, which is crazy. Only square root of n coin flips needed. OK, but that's too easy for the magician. Let's make it harder for the magician. And for this, I need a volunteer. All right. Do you know how to use a computer? OK. You've got to learn, man. a volunteer there? OK. You can volunteer later. Don't worry. There'll be lots of opportunities. Bring up. Oh, I got an email. Hold on. No, just kidding. OK. So this is a touch screen. And let's see. So if you hit a coin, it flips over. You want to try it? Yep, good. And if you hit these buttons, the whole thing rotates. OK? What's your name?
Eli.
Eli, nice to meet you. OK, I need to get blindfolded. So let's do this. Done. I'm blindfolded. Can't see anything. But just for emphasis, let's go around a couple times here. And oh, man, I always close my eyes when I do this. I don't know why.
Okay, so Eli, I'd like you to arrange those coins however you want. Heads, tails, flip over, all of them, none of them, whatever you feel like. But just make them not all the same, not all heads, not all tails, because that would be too easy for me. Okay, so they're not all the same. Now I'm going to give you an instruction, so listen to the whole instruction and then do it. The instruction is rotate the board however many times you like, and then flip over. My goal is to make them all the same, right? So rotate the board 0 times, 1 time, 2 times, whatever, and then flip the top coin and the bottom coin. So rotate as much as you want, flip top coin, bottom coin. Go for it. Okay, are they all the same? Okay. Let's see. Next, I'd like you can rotate however many times you like. This is your freedom. And then flip the top coin and the left coin. Top coin and left coin. Okay, are they all the same? No, okay. Close one, huh? Okay. I get so much from the audience here. But really, it's the same sequence no matter what. Okay, now rotate the board however many times you like, and then flip the left coin and the right coin. Yes? Are they all the same?
No.
No? Oh, okay. Never mind. I get nothing from the audience. You guys are cheating. Okay, so you have an odd number of heads. So I'd like you to flip over any one coin, any one you want. Okay. Now we're going to go through a similar sequence. So rotate the board however many times you like, and then flip over the left coin and the right coin. Are they all the same?
Yes.
Very good. Thank you, Eli. You can sit down. Hand for Eli. Oh, that was on really tight. Okay, so I did five moves? I've forgotten how many moves. Four moves. Worst case is 7. Even if there weren't rotation, the best I could do is 7 moves for 4 coins, but I got a little lucky. And there's a sequence of 7 moves, it guarantees a win. We wrote a paper about this also, actually same paper. And it turns out what's really important here is that the number of coins is a power of 2. So it would work for 1 coin, 2 coins, 4 coins, 8 coins, 16 coins, but it wouldn't work for 5 coins or 3 coins. So that's a bit surprising. And there's some deep group theoretic structure. It would work if you could flip the table upside down, though that's a little hard to do in real life. It would work on a computer. And anything, any set of operations that's a power of 2, this will work. And the magician can always win, and otherwise the spectator can win. So that's fun, mathematics inspired by magic. So that was coins. Let's do cards. And for cards and juggling, I'm going to talk about in the context of a particular kind of art goal. My father and I are both also artists, in addition to mathematicians and magicians and whatnot. We like to do art. And this is a fun way, artistically, to express mathematics. We have this series of fonts. And if you go to this website, you can play with these fonts. And each font is based around some mathematical theorem or open problem. And so we use these fonts to share the love of math with everyone. You don't need to be a mathematician to play with these fonts. So I'm going to tell you just about the latest 2. If you want to hear about the older ones, go to the website. So our latest font is based on perfect shuffling. Now, you've probably all done a regular riffle shuffle of a deck of cards. But if you're a really good magician, you can do what's called a Pharaoh shuffle, where you perfectly shuffle the cards. So you take here, this is like 3D view, here's the side view. You take, let's say you have just 8 cards, you split it perfectly in half. So we have A, B, C, D over here, E, F, G, H on the bottom. We move the right over and then fan them perfectly together. So we go A, E, B, F, C, G, D, H, and that's a perfect shuffle. So one from alternating between the 2 halves of the deck. Good magicians can do this. I'm not a good magician. I can't do it yet, but I'm going to learn tonight. Mark promised to teach me. So there's actually 2 ways to do it, depending on whether the top card comes from the top side or the bottom side. So an out shuffle, the outside cards, the top and bottom A and H, stay the outside cards, A and H, at the end. And an inside shuffle, the top and bottom cards go in a little bit. So A goes to the second position, and H goes to the second position from the bottom. Okay, so two different types of shuffles, but still pretty limited. There's only two things you can do with this deck of cards. Turns out you can do a lot with these operations. Most famously, if you have a regular 52-card deck, and you do 8 out perfect shuffles, the cards come back to their original order. So you can take perfectly, you can open up a deck. It's usually sorted in the beginning. Remove the jokers. Do 8 out perfect shuffles. It'll still be sorted. It's like, what just happened? So super cool. It turns out there's a lot of interesting mathematics here, which we don't yet understand. So for 52 cards, it's 8 out perfect shuffles. But for 38 cards, it's 36 out perfect shuffles. And in general, it's something called the order of 2 modulo n minus 1, which is a quantity we don't really know how to work with. We don't understand what the sequence of numbers looks like other than to just compute it by brute force. So this is pretty weird. Don't do imperfect shuffles, by the way. That takes a lot of imperfect shuffles to restore the order of your deck. But if we mix in and out, what other sequences can we get? I mean, keeping it sorted is interesting, but maybe we could do something else. And there's this paper by Percy Diaconis, who's a magician turned mathematician also, and Ron Graham and Bill Cantor, about what are all the configurations of cards that you can get. And as you can see from this theorem, you can get a lot. Please don't read this, but unless you know group theory. What this is saying is that just with the in and out perfect shuffle operations, you can permute, you can get almost all different stacking orders of the cards. There's one constraint called stay stack. The magicians knew, and they proved that essentially, depending on exactly how many cards you have, you can do whatever you want. So this is a powerful tool. If you're good at perfect shuffles, you can rearrange the cards to do some cool effects. So one early such effect is by this guy Elmsley from 1957. And he said, well, you know, maybe someone's just picked a card and you put it on the top of the deck. I can do a sequence of perfect shuffles and take that top card and move it to the 28th position, or whatever position I want. And all I need to do to move it to position P, I want to move to the 6th position from the top. I write 6 in binary, so in base 2, 6 is 110. And then whenever I have a 1, I do an inside perfect shuffle. Inside perfect shuffle. Whenever I have a 0, I do an outside perfect shuffle. And that will bring the top card to position P. Very simple, very clean, in a certain sense optimal. If you have, if you don't know this notation, log n, this is log base 2. It's if I take the number n of cards, I write it in binary, it's how many bits do I need to write down that number. Very fast. For 52 cards, it's 6 operations. And then Elmsley asked this question back, so this was 1957. 50 years later, his question is answered. So the question is, what if I want to do the reverse? What if I have a card that's already in position P, and I want to move it to the top? This is a lot harder. You can do it in the same number of moves, but the algorithm is more complicated. Again, don't read this. But I implemented it on the computer, and I can do it. So with the computer. Now, I said at the beginning I wanted to make a font out of this. I wanted to somehow express words of English by some kind of magical effect with perfect shuffles. So I got my alphabet deck here. And I have the cards, A through Z, perfectly sorted. And what I want to do is do a sequence of perfect shuffles and then produce whatever letter of the alphabet I want. And then do another sequence of perfect shuffles and get the next card. And so I can spell out any word slowly. And if you're really good, you can do it quickly, I suppose. So this is what it looks like. You start with the cards in order, A through Z. Here they are stacked up. And then this is what an inside perfect shuffle looks like. A goes to here, B goes to there, and so on. And I do, in this case, 4 of them. And then I produce the letter B on top of the deck. And I would show the letter B. And then I do a sequence of things. Let's have my magician computer friend do it for us. So we can take, for example, math. And then say animate. So this is going to be five operations, then the M will come out, then three operations, the A will come out, one operation T, one operation H, big finish. Okay, so we start with the cards sorted A through Z. We do outside perfect shuffle, then we do a inside perfect shuffle, then we do a outside perfect shuffle, then we do a outside perfect shuffle, and inside perfect shuffle. And there is the letter M at the top of the deck. Then you show the letter M. Then you do three more shuffles inside, outside, and inside. And there's the letter A. Boom. But the cards are all messed up at this point. None of them, it's not at all sorted. And then one more, and we get the letter T. And then one more inside perfect shuffle, and we get the letter H. So perfect shuffling makes words. Pretty cool. Fairly efficient in a certain sense. Now, I wanted to do math. I would be here all day if you wanted me to do this many perfect shuffles. I'm just going to do one perfect shuffle with these cards. And I'm going to switch to this guy. So here are my cards, and let's maybe zoom out a little bit. Okay, so I've got some of them are upside down, but X, Y, Z at the bottom, A at the top, just a bunch of cards in order, Q, R, S. Okay. Now I'm gonna cut them perfectly in half. Perfectly in half. Cheating a little bit. Okay, perfectly in half. I think that's good. And just check. Yeah, I have to think for a second. If I was good, I would shove these cards together and perfectly shuffle. But I'm going to do it the slow way, just for illustrative purposes, of course. So we're going to take. I'm going to spread out the cards a little bit. I'm going to do a perfect shuffle. So watch me. Check my work here. Shuffle, shuffle. One. Okay. In slow motion. Yeah. If I did this at full speed, you guys wouldn't be able to see what's going on. So. Two. Are you sure? Oh, I see. Gotcha. Thank you. Okay. There. Yes. Good save. I should actually watch what I'm doing, I suppose. that was not correct. Okay. I don't know what happened. We'll find out. We should edit this out later. Slightly off, but close enough. The word math is there. If I'd done it right, it would be in order, but top four is pretty good. Okay, so how did I do it? It's amazing. Okay, I believe that's the end of cards. Let us go to juggling. So again, we're going to have the goal of making a font, make letters, but we're going to do it with juggling patterns. And first, I'd like to tell you about the mathematics of juggling. Just the basics here. You've had a whole math encounters about it. So I have some juggling balls. There's this cool notation, mathematical notation, called sight swap that basically all jugglers know. And they use it to express juggling patterns and share them with each other and to design new patterns. So let me tell you how it works. It's based on numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4. And each number represents a particular kind of pattern or a piece of a pattern. So the number 1 is this pattern of juggling. So throwing one ball back and forth. You can all do this, very easy. Gets a little boring. But the way to think of it is if you draw a timeline, so I've drawn time advances vertically downward, and you alternate between left hand doing something and right hand doing something. So left hand I'm going to draw blue, right hand I'm going to draw red. So and you can skewed them a little bit. The number 1 means that whenever a hand gets a ball, it throws it to the very next time step. And then this hand gets the ball and throws it to here, throws it to here. And so you can trace this one ball going back and forth between blue and red. And so that's this pattern. Okay. Now, let's do it with the number two. Number two involves two balls. And again, and now each time you get a ball, you throw it to two time steps ahead. So you skip over this guy, throw it to there. So even numbers are going to throw to the same hand. Odd numbers are going to throw to opposite hands. And this is juggling two balls. Nothing happens. Or if you like, yeah, thank you for clapping. Here's two ball juggling. You could do this as well. So every ball comes back two time steps later. I throw the other ball in between when the first ball arrives, or thrown and arrives. OK, I've been belaboring. Let's go to three. Three, you've all seen the regular three ball cascade. And that is represented by the number three. And you can draw it by each time you get a ball, you throw it to three time steps ahead. And if you trace where that ball goes, you can follow this path. And it will be different from this path. And that will be different from this path. But there will only be three paths. And that's why there are only three balls in the number three. Okay, not too surprising. Then you can go up to four balls. With four balls, because the numbers are even, wow, gotta not juggle. Gotta juggle, rather. So that's four. They throw to the same hand. They're separate. Okay. Now, what's cool about this is when you start mixing numbers. So let's do a pattern called 441. This was originally invented because of site swap notation. It didn't exist before. And you couldn't really describe it to anyone except to say 441, 441, 441, 441, 441, 441. OK, so that it involves three balls, if you can count. And the idea is that at the first time, thank you, you throw four time steps ahead, then you throw four time steps ahead, then you throw one time step ahead. That's the near throw. And then that ball gets thrown four, and so on. So you go through that pattern cyclically. And so the power of site swap notation in this mathematics was to invent new patterns and to be able to communicate patterns between jugglers. So that's cool. Now, there are other juggling patterns that aren't really well represented by site swap notation. So this is a pattern called Mill's Mess. One of my favorites. And it's weird. But if you uncross the arms, it's just three ball juggling. So it's from a, if I drew the picture, I guess I didn't draw it here, it's exactly the same as three. So there's something going on with the hand motion where I'm crossing and uncrossing my arms that you can't capture with this particular mathematical tool. And so we wanted to capture this idea that, well, juggling is a little more than just site swap notation. What weird things could we do with that? Well, we made a font. So for each letter of the alphabet, we made a juggling pattern. And the idea is if you watch the juggling pattern, like here, I'll do the letter A. So there's this called the half shower. And if you exposed for a long time with a camera, or you just imagine these are balls of fire. We couldn't get fire in here. And you just use persistence of vision. This would spell the letter A. You would see the letter A. It's tracing the letter A. Well, some rendition of the letter A. And B is rotated 90 degrees. C is rotated 90 degrees. Most of these are right side up. And a lot of them are actually standard juggling patterns. Some of them are cheating. But we do what we can with juggling. And there you go. So you could spell, and at various occasions I've had lines of jugglers, each one doing a letter, and you can spell a word. I will, and if you play with the software, you can type, you know, any message you want, like math for the win. And there are your jugglers performing that trick. I will try to do the letter M. So letter M for math, letter M for MoMath, letter M for Museum, letter M for Mossum. OK, letter M. You're not impressed. OK. I was all set to make a gravity wave joke if it dropped, but it didn't drop. So no gravity wave joke for you. that was a joke, so. OK. So that's my gravity illusions. Next, let's tie some things up with rope. So this is a magic trick that came from the puzzle community. So let me set it up. You have a picture you'd like to hang. Normally, you hang a picture on a nail. This is a two-dimensional picture of a nail. And if the nail falls out, then the picture falls, and you're just sad, maybe. And so you decide to invest in two nails, and you hang the picture on the two nails. If one falls out, the picture's still up. Might be crooked, but it doesn't fall and break. If both nails come out, the picture falls. All good so far, pretty obvious. But I'm a really weird mathematician, and I would like to hang a picture on two nails so that if either of the nails comes out, the picture falls. Is this possible? Why would you want to do this? I don't know. But it's fun. That's the reason. So I have some rope, and I need a volunteer. All right, come on up. What's your name?
Justin.
Justin. All right. Have you ever been tied up before? No. OK, good. That's the right answer. OK. What I'd like you to do is hold your arms like this against your body, and face the audience a little bit further horizontal. Good. All right. Now, you are the nails. Embrace it. Feel the nails. OK? And hold them like this. I'm going to hang the picture like this. OK? And if I remove one of the arms, let's say I remove this arm, then the picture falls. OK? Arm back up. If I hang it the same way and I remove this arm, OK? Picture falls. Believe me? Maybe? Do I do the same thing every time? Justin, you can sit down. I claim there's one thing I was doing. It was this. And if you stare at it long enough, if one of the nails comes out, the rest falls away. But this is hard. We should use mathematics to figure this out. So here's one way to think of it topologically, connect to something you may have seen. Essentially, these nails are like infinite lines. The rope is not allowed to penetrate that line. It's stuck here. And if I remove one of those lines, the whole thing falls apart. Another way to think of lines is like big circles out at infinity. So at this point, I have three loops. I have this purple loop, I have this purple loop, and then I have the rope loop. You can't see it, but the picture's down at the bottom. And so that closes the loop. And what I'm saying is I have three loops that are intertwined. But if I remove one of the purple loops, the other two fall apart. Is that possible? Yes, we just did it. But why is it possible? It's called the Borromean rings. It's older than Borromeo. You've probably seen this pattern before. It has the property that all three of them together are interlocked. There's no way to separate one from the other two. But if you somehow erase one of them, then the other two fall apart. If I erase this blue one, then you can see the purple. And the blue is entirely on top of the purple. And so there you go. So it's actually very symmetric in this view. Two of these are nails, and the other one is rope. Which is which? Doesn't matter. It's the same. Weird. So let's try to generalize. Maybe I have three nails instead of two. And I want it that if I remove any one of those nails, the picture falls. Is this possible? Let's get a couple more volunteers, please. Anyone like, yeah, come on up. I need another one. Yes, come on up. Have you ever been tied? No. I won't ask. OK, so stand next to each other, side by side. Face the audience. Get a little closer. OK, arms up. OK, like this. Good. All right, so we're going to do these two arms, and then this arm. And what do I want to do next? I think these two. And this one seems right. OK, you missed. Could you pick a arm 1, 2, or 3?
2.
Hopefully I got this right. Yes. You have to imagine infinite gravity here. OK, picture falls. Good, good, good. Let's do 4, shall we? I have to untangle this rope a little bit. Don't want you to get stuck. OK, so arms up. So we're going to do 1 out of 4. So
something like this, and then something like this, and then something like this, and something like this. I think that's it. Okay, we can leave them there. I think it's enough. let's see. Someone I don't know. You, sir. Pick an arm, 1, 2, 3, or 4. 2. Popular choice today. All right, so we remove the second arm. And yes, that looks good. That falls. Okay, now we're hopefully left with the 2-arm something. Pull this through. Okay. And this is the slow part, the infinite gravity. Takes a while. Okay. And the picture fell. Thank you. Okay, so how did I do that? How did I know what sequence to do those operations? Well, mathematics. So one answer would be topology. Maybe you happen to know there's something called Brunian links that generalize Borromean rings. They look something like this, where you have, in this case, 4 interlocked things. And if I remove any one of them, the others fall apart. So if you know that exists, great. And you know, we Googled and found, yeah, it exists. Good, we can use it. You just kind of straighten out those circles and then turn them into infinite lines and then kind of rearrange things and turn them into this vertical picture and then shrink those down, and you've got your nails and hanging picture. And this is actually what I did when we were doing 3 nails. But that's hard. Topology is hard. What if we could use some other approach to analyze the same problem? And the answer is algebra. Algebra is super powerful tool, super cool in this context. We're just going to abstract a little bit and say, look, we've got, in this case, we've got 2 nails. Let's understand the 2-nail solution. It looks like this gibbery mess. But if I write it algebraically, it looks very simple and beautiful. So what this notation says is that x1 means go clockwise around. So I'm starting here. First, I go clockwise around the first nail. That's what x1 means. Then I go clockwise around the second nail. That's x2. Then I go counterclockwise around the first nail. That's I'm going to write as x1 inverse, x1 to the minus 1 power. And then I go counterclockwise around x2, so I write x2 inverse. That is a solution that I've been doing over and over. It looks very nice when you write it in sequence, x1, x2, x1 inverse, x2 inverse. And you can kind of imagine that if I removed one of the nails, say I remove x1, then these 2 things disappear, and I'm left with x2 followed by x2 inverse, which means I go clockwise around the second nail, and then immediately I go counterclockwise. Well, that's nothing. That's equivalent to doing nothing, and so everything separates. So if I remove the x1s, the x2s cancel. If I remove the x2s, the x1s cancel. That's cool. So that's kind of why this works. Now let's try to generalize. This seems like a much easier picture to imagine. I'm going to introduce some notation. Instead of writing the things 4 times, I'm just going to write each of them once. With square brackets, that means I do x1, then I do x2, then I do x1 inverse, then I do x2 inverse. This is a thing in mathematics called the commutator, if you know group theory. OK, so let's try to do 3 nails. So I have this solution for 2 nails. If I just take that solution, call it p2, and I plug it into this magical commutator operation and say, well, let's do p2, then x3, then p2 inverse, then x3 inverse, that should also work, because either this falls apart or this falls apart whenever I remove one of the 3 nails. And so you just work it out and do the computation, and there's like some little formulas you remember from algebra. And bingo, you get a sequence of operations. I do x clockwise around the first nail, clockwise around the second, counterclockwise around the first, and so on. And eventually, you get this solution, if you draw it out, or the one that I was executing. But it's easy to remember for me, because I just think, oh, I do the solution for 2 nails, then I do clockwise around the 3rd nail, then I do the anti-solution for 2 nails, which I happen to have memorized, and then the counterclockwise around x3. So far, so good. That's 3 nails. So of course, we can do the same thing to make 4 nails. We take this solution, which is getting a little bit complicated, a little long, and I just commutate it with x4. So I do p3, x4, p3 inverse, x4 inverse. Trouble,
that we start to notice is that P3 is this giant thing. P3 inverse is another giant thing of the same length. So every time I add a nail, I'm doubling the length of my solution. So in this case, I get that thing, which I could not execute. I don't have enough rope. But I did four nails somehow. And luckily, there's a more efficient solution. This solution I call bad because the length of it grows exponentially. It more than doubles every single time we add a nail. And one of the things I teach it to all of my students is exponential bad, polynomial good in terms of growth. So this is bad. We want something better. And the better thing is a very simple idea. Instead of adding one nail at a time, I'm going to take my nails, split them in half. So I have four nails. Let's look at the first two nails. First two nails, I know what to do. It's just this thing. And then the second two nails, the last two nails, it's the same thing. I just replace one with three and two with four. So that's super efficient. I really know how to do two nails. I really nailed it, right? So now I take these two solutions, and I apply the commutator. I just take that one. This is P1:2, the first two nails. So I take this one, then I do this one, then I do this inverse, then I do this inverse. Now, it looks like I still doubled things, right? This thing appears twice. This thing appears twice. But these are actually really short because they only involve half of the nails. So I took half of the thing, and then I doubled it. Turns out this thing grows quadratically, which is way, way, way better than exponential growth. So in the particular case of four nails, this is what I executed. It's getting longer, but it's still within the realm of my short rope. And if you did this with eight nails, this would only be this would be, I think, twice as large, whereas the other solution would be 16 times as large. So you get a big win, especially with large numbers of nails. So that was some algorithms for you. Polynomial good, remember. Let's do some puzzles. I could use some more volunteers. So meanwhile, think about this picture and what it means. What's it going to do? Come on here, stage center. OK, that's a lot. So we'll start with two. Join. Actually, yeah, let's do two. OK, so here's the pattern. We're going to do x1, x2, x3. Then we're going to do x1 inverse, x2 inverse, x3 inverse. What does this do? It's a puzzle for you.
Two, and it will fall?
Any two, it will fall. Very good. Let's try it. So if I remove one of them, then I get the, if you've memorized by now, this is the two-nail solution. So if I remove any one of the remaining nails, then the picture falls. OK. So far, so good. You guys can sit back down. I got to get through a lot of volunteers here. I need to do one more trick. So come closer. I want you to be as far away from me as I am from you. So step back. No. OK. So I'm going to need all four arms. OK, put these against your body. Very good. I think you get the idea, probably. But. How many nails does it take? How many nails do I have to remove for this to fall?
Three.
Three. Good. I remove one of them. OK. I remove another one. And so we're down to the two-nail solution. I remove a third one. And boom, the picture falls. OK. Easy enough. Let's do slightly more interesting. Arms up. OK. So we're going to do x1, x2, x3, x4, x2 inverse, x1 inverse, x4 inverse, and x3 inverse. What does this do?
Remove any two and it will fall?
Remove any two and it will fall. Yeah. Let's try. So maybe we remove the middle arms. So we move this one. Okay, and then we remove this one. And we have the two-nail solution. So two nails was not enough to remove. I think this is irrecoverable at this point. Let's do it one more time. So arms up. If I remove four, it definitely falls. I agree with you there. If I remove three, it also falls. But check this out. I remove just this one. OK, it didn't fall. And then I remove this one, and the picture falls. Ah, interesting. So what's going on here is I've linked X1 and X2 actually always appear together. Essentially, his hands were acting as a single nail, and your hands were acting as a single nail. So I had to remove both of your hands or both of your hands. Very good. OK. I'm going to do one more trick, which is not drawn here. You guys can go. And very good. Let's try. So for fun, I'm going to do another trick, this one. So I think it's clear what this does, but I'll execute it anyway. So actually, I'll tell you what it does, because I want to make it clear. I want to set things up so that if I remove either of your left hands, then the picture falls, or if I remove both of your right hands. So either left or both rights should make this picture fall. Let's do it. Arms up. Either left or both rights. Okay, either left or both rights. They're rights, yeah? Okay, so we have four arms. You, sir, could you pick an arm, 1, 2, 3, or 4?
Three.
That's a right arm, so it should not fall. Okay, it's a little bit of slack here, but it stays. Okay, you want to pick another one?
One.
The other right arm. So both right arms, this is the ultimate test. Did I get the left arms correct? It should all fall, because we removed both of the right arms. Looks a little bit tangled, but it's okay. Magical infinite gravity. Yes. Ooh, I have the end here. Can't drop that one. And it goes over here. And goes over. You know, if I got it right every time, it wouldn't look that hard. Let's try it one more time. Okay. Okay, I should pay attention to what's written on the screen. I do either left, either left or both rights, and then either left or both rights. Okay. Yes? Pick an arm, any arm. You, sir, pick an arm. Okay, I'll get the saw, and we'll cut it off. Okay, so that was a left arm, thank you. Maybe, I don't know. Now somehow everything has to fall apart. So this is going to come here, and then this is going to come here, and then this falls there, and then this. Yay, it works. Thank you. Whew. Okay, second time's a charm. What's cool is that you can do anything you want in this world, at least in theory. So you can do what's called any monotone Boolean function. What that means is if I remove more arms, more nails, of course, it's only more likely that the thing is going to fall. If I remove these three and it falls, and then I also remove this one, it's not going to magically hang back together. So that's called monotonicity. Removing more only makes more falling happen. But otherwise, you can do whatever you want. You can say, well, if I remove this nail and these two nails over here, or if I remove this nail and that nail, or if I remove the blue nail and seven red nails, or whatever, however you want to do it, you can make the picture fall only when that happens, and exactly when that happens. And it's a fairly complicated solution. In fact, the number of operations I need to do grows exponentially in the number of nails. That's annoying, but it's actually the best you can do. When we were doing the one out of n trick, that was actually special that you could do it so efficiently. And that's why beyond four nails, it gets a little bit unwieldy. But you can do anything you want. And I think this problem in particular is really fun because it started as a puzzle. I like to perform it as a magic trick.
But it led to all of this very rich stuff. We went to topology and algebra and monotone function theory, which is, comes up in cryptography and computational complexity. And we were using algorithms and efficiency and polynomial good and exponential bad. And lots of cool things came out of this little puzzle. So thank you. But there's more. My mainstay, in some sense, is paper folding. I do origami and origami sculpture. But I also like to do origami magic. So, and this is where I got started when I was a grad student looking for some interesting problem to solve. And I was reading Martin Gardner, and he wrote about this magic trick, which is described here in ancient Japanese in 1721. The question is, if I take this polygon, it's a Japanese emblem, and I put it on a piece of paper, is there some way to fold that piece of paper, make one complete straight cut, and produce exactly that picture? So I'm not going to do exactly that picture, but let's try something. So here I have a piece of paper. I've just folded it flat, and I make one complete straight cut. So here we go. One cut, I get two pieces, and in this piece, I get a little five-pointed star. Okay, not impressed. Let's do another one. That's okay. That's okay. You don't lie. Here's another picture. Another pre-folded piece of paper. Make one complete straight cut. Get two pieces. This one has a swan. Let's see, what else do I have here? Maybe I take this one, make one complete straight cut. Hold on to the piece I want, and I get a little camera with a tripod. Wow, okay, now you're impressed. The video crew is impressed. We actually did this ahead of time, and that was the camera they were using. I wish. Fully functional. We are working on making printable robots, pieces of paper that can become robots, but haven't yet made a piece of paper that can become a camera. Well, it's not in the same way. Not a video camera. Here's a little maple leaf. I'm Canadian, so I'm gonna do that. Okay, I think that's probably enough for now. It turns out, well, there's a story that in 1777, some of you may know that date, Betsy Ross was commissioned to make the American flag. And the question was, how many points should the star have on the American flag? And George Washington wanted 6, and Betsy Ross wanted 5. And so she took a piece of paper, folded it flat, made one complete straight cut, and poof, a regular five-pointed star. See how easy it is to make them? We can do this with fabric. We can make your flags. Sadly, this story is probably not true. But it was an inspiration for a painting in 1932, and it was probably manufactured for Harper's New Monthly magazine as a story in 1873. Still an old story, even if it's not all the way back to 1777. Oh well. More to the story. In 1922, before Houdini was a famous escape artist, he was a general magician. He did lots of different things, and he did paper magic. He also probably didn't write this book. It's probably ghostwritten, but I'm hopeful that he performed this trick at least, which is, here it is, folding a five-pointed star. And you have in your packets a method for doing regular five-pointed star. We will get to that in a moment. More history. This another magician, Gerald Lowe, in 55, wrote a book all about this thing. He could make an arrangement of 5 things, each of which looks like a star. He could make cards appear, so 4 of spades and things like that. So he was using it for magic. And then Martin Gardner wrote about it in 1960. And this is one of the tricks that was in the magic literature. It's like, what can we do? What are the limits? Is there some general theory for how to make things? So we formulated this as a math problem. You've given a square paper, say. You want to fold it flat, make one complete straight cut, to produce some shape, or maybe many shapes all at once. What can you make? And this actually is a crease pattern. It's like presented here as a puzzle or a magic trick. If I cut here, after folding along these lines, what do you get? And you've already seen the answer, it's the swan. But not so obvious. How do you go from the swan to the creases? Well, it turns out there's an algorithm to do it. So this was my first result as a PhD student back in the day. That given any polygon or even a collection of polygons, you can fold them all flat, fold the piece of paper flat, make one straight cut, and produce exactly those shapes that you want. So this is fun. You can entertain your friends, and you can do magic. So let's do some magic. Push a button. OK. This is an old trick. I take a rectangle of paper. And this trick has some pattern to it. So imagine there are two politicians. I know, hard to imagine there's only two politicians. But it's election season. So you know, it comes down to two candidates. We'll call one of them the good candidate, loved by the people, and the other one the bad candidate, hated by the people. So these two politicians, in a tragic accident, die at the same time, car accident. And they both happen to be Christians, so they go to the gates of heaven. And at the gates of heaven, there's a dude, St. Peter, yeah. And St. Peter says, well, not just anyone can go into heaven. To go into heaven, you need a ticket. And only the good politician is good enough to have a ticket to heaven. And he takes his ticket and folds it flat. And then he takes his scissors, because you never go anywhere without scissors, and he cuts along a straight line. Okay? And he hands all these pieces to the bad politician. And the bad politician doesn't know what to do with them, so he hands them to St. Peter. And St. Peter says, well, gee, this is a weird thing to do to your ticket. It doesn't seem like such a good idea. Let's see, maybe if I arrange the pieces in some way, it does something. It's white on white, hopefully you can see. We have H, E, L, L. Okay, so the bad politician goes straight to hell, where his ticket says to go. And the good politician hung on to one piece, and that piece lets him into heaven. Okay, so that's the old trick. And you know, we mathematician types are never satisfied. We always want to do a little bit better. And so that trick involves three pieces for the H, three pieces for the E, and one piece for each of the L's. So can we do better? Well, maybe if we fold a piece of paper in this way and make one complete straight cut. We still get a bunch of pieces, because we need one for each thing. And I forget which is which. Let's see. Get it right. Here we go. Yes, maybe. Yes. OK, here is the letter H in one piece. Kind of a nice H. Here is the letter E. A little bigger. And then we have a couple of L's. Okay, and then we also have the cross, all from one rectangle of paper. Isn't that nice? And here's how it's arranged. So we just found a way to decompose a rectangle into all the letters we wanted. And then magically, our algorithm tells us how to fold it. And then we make the cut, and we're done. One more trick. This is another kind of classic. So suppose I have a checkerboard piece of paper. Now, I've got white squares, I've got black squares. They're all kind of mixed together. What if I'd really like to separate them? I want to have all the black squares on this side of the room, all the white squares on that side of the room. Can I do it?
Why, yes, by folding. So here it is. I'm going to fold along this line. Fold along this line. And by the way, I know that real checkerboards have 8x8, but this is only 4x4. To do 8x8, you need really thin paper. It used to be sold as onion skin paper. So here I have a 2x2 checkerboard. Very, very short games of checkers on a 2x2 board. And then I fold some diagonals. And look, I've got all of the black squares on one side and all the white squares on the other. I can cut it for emphasis. We cut along this straight line. I have all of the white squares. Each of them is unharmed, and all of the black squares on the other side. I didn't quite cut the corner, but close. Here's a little white square, and another light square, and there's a lot of them. All right. One more. Where is it? Oh, all right, I don't have it. This is such an easy trick. You can do it with a rectangle of paper without any guidelines. So I'm going to fold a piece of paper in half. This is a brand new trick invented yesterday. And then I'm going to fold a little line over here. Two parallel lines. And now the hard part, I'm going to fold something. Yeah. Something like this. Three folds. Did I do it right? Maybe. We'll find out. No turning back. So I'm going to cut along a straight line, parallel to the last fold. Hold on to one of the pieces, I get our good friend, the letter M. Yay. And this is also in your packet. And the next thing we're going to do is to play with your packet. So that wraps up the different mathematical things I wanted to talk about: coins, cards, juggling, rope, paper. Lots of ways you can combine math and magic. A lot of fun. And so I would like you to explore it with me in the context of this last trick, which is folding and one straight cut. So there are, you have 10 pages. The top five are a sequence of challenges, puzzles, mini versions that walk you through how we discovered how to make any shape by folding a one straight cut. First, if I give you two lines and I only give you one cut, how can you cut both of these lines with one cut and one fold? That's a hint. What if I have three folds, three cuts I want to make with one cut? What if I have three weirder cuts I want to make with one fold? What if I have four cuts I want to make with one cut? Sorry. What if I only have half of a cut I want to make with one cut? That was a puzzle for a while. If you want to explore the mathematics of folding and cutting, use the first five pages. And or, if you want to just fold stuff and have fun with that, the last five pages are a sequence of little exercises like fold here, fold here, fold here, cut there, and you'll make something. I already showed you. Here you fold along the line of symmetry, and then you fold along these lines. And the dashed lines you fold one way, and the dot dashed lines you fold the other way. So one's valley and one's mountain. The order is all the folds get folded simultaneously. So in practice, what you do, so for the line of symmetry, first you fold the first fold, and then you're going to fold through both layers. Okay. Then what you do, you say, oh, I've got these four folds I need to do. How do I do them all at once? Well, you fold one of them, then you unfold it. You fold the second one, unfold. Fold the third one, unfold. Fold the fourth one, unfold. So they're pre-creased. And then you fold them all at once. This one is really easy. This one is pretty easy. This one is not so easy, and this one is not so easy. So depending on your level of comfort, you can start at the end or start at the beginning or whatever you want to do. Let's fold some paper. I will walk around and...
Don't stop folding because you can listen while other people are talking. We want to have a little opportunity for just a couple of questions for our speaker, as is traditional. So if there's something about, let's see if I can remember the five things without looking. Coins, cards, rope, paper, or the thing that's gravity illusion. If you have a question about any of those five things, please raise your hand and I'll come on over and you can get a chance to hear what Professor Demaine has to say on that particular topic. So, do I have any questions? Yes, or anything else you could, yes. Yeah, oh, right here, I've got one right here.
Ask me anything.
Stand up, please.
So, do you know anything about smooshing? Like Percy Diaconis's smooshing?
Oh, I don't know about smooshing. I've seen Leonard Green smoosh so many times, it's so amazing. It's a technique of, it looks like you're just moving cards around and they're falling off the table. Usually you're blindfolded, or I've seen blind magicians do it. And so there's like cards all over the place. And then you take a dagger and stab the card you were looking for.
Yeah, or, I mean, I just mean the shuffling.
Oh, I see.
Just the shuffling technique of like,
yeah,
you just put all your cards in a pile and you just kind of,
right, when you're a kid, you like arrange all the cards in the table, move them around, and hope that they mix. Yeah. I don't know anything about it. Sorry.
Okay, let's give Professor Demaine a second try. I see a question over there.
You mentioned that a lot of your work is group theory, and I noticed, but have you ever used it where you're more continuous groups like Lie algebras?
Have I used Lie algebras?
Yeah, just curious for different.
No, I have not used Lie algebras.
I noticed that your groups are not continuous.
Yeah, it's a fine question. I lean towards what's called elementary mathematics. It doesn't use a lot of fancy tools. Because I'm a computer scientist. I only know, I know a lot of mathematics, but I enjoy more the kind of more basic tools combined in more advanced ways. But to each their own. Please use Lie algebras to solve a magic problem.
Let's just take one moment out of our folding. You can continue to fold after this, but let's take one moment out of our folding to thank our speaker one more time.
Thanks.